on a shout of praise. Hallelujah. Yes, this time you can hear. Hallelujah. Father Lord, all that we've prayed about today, Lord, we will begin to see an immediate manifestation. Amen. In the name of Jesus. We haven't sung songs. We've prophesied the divine word of God into situations. Be glorified in our children. Be lifted up in our churches. Be lifted up in this nation. Be lifted up in the hearts of people. Let the hearts of people be drawn to God. I declare a radar, a magnet on our lives to begin to attract and identify people and be a blessing and bring them and minister to them. You will be exalted in this nation. So shall it be, Lord. In Jesus' name we declare. Amen. Amen. Shout a big amen if you believe so. Okay. Hallelujah. Matthew chapter 7. You know, our time is fast spent, so I'll just share this briefly and then I'll continue. Matthew chapter 7, verse 7 to 11. Matthew 7, 7. It's a popular scripture. You've heard it many times. It says, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and it will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives. And that's where the problem is. Not the child crying, that scripture. For everyone who asks receives. And he who seeks finds. This is very important. Just stay with me here. For everyone who asks receives. And he who seeks finds. To him who knocks, it will be opened. What man is there among you who, if his son asks for bread, will give him a stone? Or if he asks for fish, will give him a serpent? If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father, who is in heaven, give good things to those who ask him? Go back to verse 7. Ask, and it will be given to you. Seek, and you will find. Knock, and it will be opened to you. Next verse. For everyone who asks, everyone, without exception. Say, that includes me. Say, that includes me. For everyone who asks receives. Everyone who asks receives. Everyone who seeks finds. Everyone who knocks, it will be opened. But there is a problem here. Have you one of the greatest scriptures? To me, I'm just saying it is. I'm not saying it's a doctrine. I think one of the greatest scriptures that was written with regards to this was what Jesus and David said. David in Psalms chapter 5 and verse 1 says, "Give ear to my words, O Lord. Consider my meditation." Give ear to my words, O Lord. Consider my meditation. Hearken unto the voice of my cry, my King and my God. For unto thee will I pray. My voice you will hear in the morning. O Lord, in the morning will I direct my prayer unto thee, will look up. Give ear to my words, O Lord, consider my meditation. Hearken, David. Jesus confirmed David. He says, "Ask, shall be given unto you. Seek, you shall find. Knock, you shall." For who? Anyone. For everyone. Everyone. Everyone who asks. Everyone. Everyone who asks. I'm already in Matthew 7. Everyone who asks. Everyone who asks receives. Everyone who seeks finds. Everyone who knocks, it will be opened. I'm going to, for the next 1 or 2 weeks, talk to you about praying with expectation. Because why is this scripture not fulfilled? Praying with expectation. Praying with for everyone who asks is asking because they are expecting that they are going to receive. The problem with Christians is that we are praying without expectation. Pastor D read a scripture some time ago when I was not around, in Acts chapter 12. Let's just run through this scripture. Maybe we'll run through scriptures today and then I'll teach next week. But look at Acts chapter 12. This story is a classic example of praying without expectation. And you know, there's so many Christians that pray. Let me give you an example before we go to Acts chapter 12. We got a phone call this week and someone close to me and said that, should I go for they got a fantastic deal. Absolutely fantastic. It's a fantastic deal that it is a shocking, surprising, unexpected, not realistic in the natural kind of deal. Hello? I remembered a long time ago, I didn't have a car and I wanted to buy a car. I didn't have enough money. So while I was at work, I was just discussing with somebody and the person said, I think I saw somebody. My neighbor wants to sell their car in Catford. I said, really, Catford? I said, okay, let me just go with you. Went there. I don't know, some of you might not know this. We used to have this car called the Maestro. And got to the car, saw the car. The window was the screen, as if they've just did some work on it or something. But didn't look, and we were talking, and they said, okay, how much do you want for the car? And the guy said, anyway, he said an amount, and I jokingly said £175. And he looked at me, he said, are you kidding? I said, £175. I said, okay, because my neighbor brought you, I'll say that. And I looked at him and said, No. There's something wrong with this car. As I felt, you know, I felt it in my left foot. And there was something wrong with the car. That's wrong. So while I was there, thank God for mobile phones, I called my brother and I said, oh, I saw a car. He says, 175. I said, 175? I said, that's what I felt. I said, there's something wrong with that car. And he said something. He said, you see, why do you think that God could not have led you to a deal of 175? Why was the first thing that something is wrong? And but besides, 175, even if something is wrong, 175, even if you lose 175, oh dear. So I bought the car, drove it away, still with expectation that something was wrong with the car. Drove it. And nearly after about 8 months, sold the car again for £350. So I got this call. Well, you know, you learn lessons, you know. So this person, they said, but I feel that something. I said, you see, I said, my brother, over the phone, I said, you fasted for 31 days. What exactly are you expecting? A deal that everybody gets or a deal that is divine? Oh, I'll call you back. They've got the message. We pray so much. In fact, you know, I want us to pray less and have big expectation. We pray so much with all kinds of diverse prayers. But praying is not the issue. It's expectation. Many people pray and are not expectant. Oh, you pray, God, in the name of Jesus, change my wife. And all of a sudden, your wife suddenly just changed. Suddenly. Not that there was a process. Bah! As if there was a transplant. No. They're off to something. What do you want? You know, let me tell you something. Sometimes it's not that we're not expectant, but we're expectant in a natural way. We have a way we expect things to happen, and not a divine way. Give me this Acts chapter, whatever I said. Now, about that time, Herod the king stretched out his hand to harass some from the church. I think Pastor D read this some weeks ago. Then he killed James, the brother of John, with the sword. And because he saw that it pleased the Jews, he proceeded further to seize Peter also. Now, it was during the days of the unleavened bread. So when he had arrested him, he put him in prison, delivered him to 4 squad of soldiers to keep him. 4 squad, intending to bring him before the people after Passover. Peter was therefore kept in prison, but constant prayer was offered to God for him by the church. Constant. A version says unceasing prayer. Continuous prayer. And what was the prayer point? I can imagine the prayer point. Pentecostal, black Pentecostal prayer point. Deep rooted in the African, Caribbean, Congolese, Ghanaian kind of prayer. God, by miracle, let transform him. Let just carry him. Let him just disappear. Those are the kind of prayer. It's not prayer that God touched the heart of Herod. No. There's some dangerous kind of prayer. Some prayer points that you wouldn't find anywhere. Uncommon kind of prayer points. The prayer points that even God did not design it. It's not normal prayer. I'm telling you. It's a supernatural prayer point. I'm telling you that. God, especially after they had killed James, it wouldn't be God touch the heart of the judge. Let them just have a heart transplant. No. God, by fire. Let fire just consume the whole. Let there be an earthquake. There will be, I'm telling you, I just can't imagine. Constant prayer by the church. Don't forget that the Holy Ghost had come upon them. They were speaking in tongues. So they will be downloading some serious kind of prayer, man. Hallelujah. See, if we had that problem here, if I line up 10 people here, the different kind of prayer points that will be downloaded, you will be shocked. There will be the English kind of prayer points, the Northeast kind of prayer points, Middlesbrough kind of prayer points, Manchester, Arsenal will come up with his own. And then there will be all kinds. Then we come by village prayer points. They will be dangerous, different kind of prayer. In fact, that other one say, you will hear prayer points that, although Elder Andrew has said we should pray about this, but I'm coming from a different angle. So let's agree that these prayer points are not just God just releasing more. No, forget it. Okay, verse 6. And when Herod was about to bring him out, that night Peter was sleeping, bound with two chains between two soldiers, and the guards before the door were keeping the prison. Now behold, an angel of the Lord stood by. This is what we are saying. This is what we've prayed. I told you. In fact, by the time you think, did not one person in the prayer room raise this angelic prayer point? So thank God, the angel came, stood by him, like Sean in the prison, struck Peter by the side, and raised him up, saying, struck, didn't just tap him, beat the guy, or like, my friend, wake up. Because you know, many of you are so Pentecostal, Jesus must have tapped him. No, struck. I don't know if he kicked him or something. Like, get up, arise quickly, and his chains fell off his hands. Aha, aha. Those are our prayer points. Angel must come. Chains will just suddenly fall. I'm telling you. Break the chains. I'm telling you. Even Minister Gordon will come up with some songs that you will fight back. All chains will be. These are songs and prayer points. So, next verse. Prayer. Then the angel said to him, guard yourself, tie on your sandals. So he did. And he said to him, put on your garment and follow me. Go on. So he went and followed him and did not know that what was done by the angel was real. But thought he was seeing a vision. Of course, this was part of our prayer point. Let even Peter not know what is happening to him. No, it's part of the prayer point. Peter himself would not even realize. He would just suddenly appear. And they would pray the prayer point that God, you remember when you used to suddenly appear in our midst. One time, God, he would suddenly appear. Those are prayer points by the church. Pentecostal, charismatic, tongue-talking, Bible-bashing, Episcopalian, Christian. So he went out and followed him and did not know. Go to the next verse. When they were past the first and second guard post, they came to the iron gates that leads to the city, which opened to them of his own accord. That is prayer. Lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be lifted up, O ye everlasting Lord, that the King of glory may come in. Who is the king? Show yourself, mighty Lord. In the name of the gates just suddenly open. These were their prayer points. And they went out and went down one street, and immediately the angel departed from him. Go on. And when Peter had come to himself, of course, it's part of the prayer point. He said, now I know for certain that the Lord has sent his angel and has delivered me from the hand of Herod. And from all the expectation of the Jewish people. Fine. Good. So when he had considered this, he came to considered means that the guy must have sat down at the street thinking, right. Okay. Pinch himself. This is real. Okay. Right. Where should I go? He knew where the prayer meeting was holding. So he said he came to the house of Mary. He knew that prayer meeting. 24 hours prayer meeting. Everybody, one hour. The mother of John, whose surname was Mark, where many were gathered together praying. For who? For who? For what? Verse 13. And Peter knocked at the door of the gate. A girl named Rhoda came to answer. When she recognized Peter's voice, because of her gladness, she was expectant. She saw. She didn't call him a demon. And he said, hey! But running and announced, Peter stood before the gate. Rhoda, small gate. You know, the Bible, all ye deep rooted, you know, we are just born again. Someone like me. Just, so we have simplicity of heart. You know, many people, you've sometimes too much scripture can destroy you. Even Proverbs says that, do not be overwise, do not be over righteous. Why should thou destroy thyself? We have a Pentecostal analytical way of how things should manifest itself in the presence of the brethren. She left Peter there. She didn't open the door. Because the expectations will cause... You know, when you're expecting something, and the Bible says that hope defied make the heart sick. But when the desire comes, it is like a tree of life. See, when you are expecting something, something comes, you are stupefied. You just stood there saying, Jesus. You've entered into an entropy of lack of understanding. You just enter into a spiritual, Holy Ghost, mental problem. My God, your brain senses are all suspended. You can't even say, thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. So the girl, when he saw Peter, said, straightforward, prayers are answered. Because it was in the middle of the night, so there was no judge. Jury doesn't sit till the morning. So she knew that this was not Herod's doing. Running, Peter stood before the gate. Next verse. But they said to her, you are beside yourself. No, that's too nice. They said, she's mad. That's the right word. Eh? And the street word is, which one would you have said, you know? Yeah, you're crazy, you're bonkers. Something wrong with you. They're pronouncing, you are praying. And they came to give you an answer. And you're telling the person you are mad. How many people have you told they are mad when they've brought the result of your answer? Person? Yet she kept insisting. Kept insisting means how long? And I could assume that people like the Bible would have said, please, we are praying at the moment. You are seeing something else. Let's finish this session of our own 1 hour, then we'll get back to you. Because it seems that you don't understand what you see, things that are happening in the spirit. You are a young girl. You don't understand. Then when she wasn't keeping quiet, then they now wanted to interpret to her. I'm going to round up very soon. They want to interpret her. See, what you saw was an angel. See, because you've been praying so much, God now, see, the Bible says that, oh my goodness. This is the problem we're having. This is not about these disciples. They were Holy Ghost filled, tongue talking Christians. Who has seen Jesus, walked with Jesus, seen miracles, signs and wonders. So don't put yourself in a position that you are. No. Yet, they were interpreting. I see the word of God, say, angel. Come on. Peter continued knocking. Oh, these men of little faith. Peter understood because he was there before. Peter has been in that position before. Jesus, if it is you, bid me to come. Eh? And walking on water and say, eh? Saw the wind. Say, did Jesus not tell me to come? Jesus, did I not tell you to come? So he understood. He knew the Thomases. So he kept on knocking that sooner. And when they opened the door at him, they were astonished. Astonished. I thought you were praying. Go to verse 17. I don't know where this thing is. He can't keep silent. He declared to them how the Lord had brought him out of the prison. And he was telling them how to brought them out. Minister Enoch raised that prayer point of an angel. Do you remember? Then the Aurora was, we prayed that the chains would drop off, that the doors would open. That's not the point. The point was, when I was knocking, you didn't open the door. You said I was an angel. This is typifying us. I'm going to define later on expectation, but I believe that God has dealt with us truly today. He says, for anyone who asks, not anyone, for everyone, that's what I ask, receives. It's a done deal. It's a done deal. It's not, would I? If you, anyone who seeks will find. So there's no excuse. You seek the Lord, you'll find him. You seek a solution, you'll find him. When you start, you see, let me round up here. You see, men like Elijah and Elisha, these guys had moved to a particular level that they do not believe that what they are saying is their words. Hello? They know that when I say something, it happens. Death and life lies in the power of the tongue. Elijah will stand and say, by my word, let there be no rain for 2 hours. He's not, and then he walks away. He disappears to the brook where he will get water. He doesn't think, would this come to pass or not? See, this is the problem. You must stand in your house and say, by my word. To get to the stage of by my word, you must be entwined with God. Say, by my word. 2.5 years. He declares it and disappears. 2.5 years later, he now appears to the same king. And Elijah, he says, okay, king, get into your chariot. I hear the sound of the abundance of rain. Get into your chariot. Now, thank God, by experience, the king had already known that when this man says something, but even in church, even when the word of God is declaring a prophetic word, let us fast. God wants us to come together and pray. You know, we take it like, and then when problems come. After every fast, especially elongated fast and prayer, I instruct my secretaries that I'm not available. That's what we want to see. No, I'm not around. I'm not available. I'm doing other stuff. Because I believe that your solution would have been in that fast. You didn't show up. Then don't bring your problems to me. Before that problem came, or whilst that problem was in existence, God had told us fast. Pray. You didn't. You didn't show up. You were too concerned about your job and everything. And the day that God visited you on that problem was a Thursday night. But you decided to stay at home. So you watch EastEnders. That's your problem. EastEnders will give you your solution. And you have Sky. You didn't even know to record. You decided to go and watch Chelsea. That's your business. But then don't have to finish watching Chelsea. Come to me and disturb me when it's my turn to watch Arsenal. It's just not fair. Hallelujah. Simple as that. Anyone who asks will find. He said, by my word. He stood. In fact, he said, I hear the sound of abundance of rain. The guy went down. He was praying. He said, he told the servant, said, go and look. The servant came back. He said, there's no car. I said, my friend, go and look again. 7 times he was sending the guy. It was because he had prayed. He said he gathered himself, built up, prayed. He was expecting an answer. Not, oh, is there going to be? The way we pray sometimes is without expectation. We do all the spiritual gymnastics. If you go to the gym and you are carrying weight, what are you expecting? Eh? You want, when the sun comes out, you want the guns to come out. Isn't it? That's what they say. Isn't it, Emmanuel? Where is he? There's so many Emmanuels in church now, so we don't know. So you were expecting something to happen, isn't it?
Yes.
Hello?
Yes.
When you go to exercise, you expect something to happen. Might not necessarily be that you lose weight, but you are energized. You are healthy. Sometimes it's not going to the gym to lose weight. It's to have energy, to be able to walk effectively, to do stuff. You know, when you decide to give up that Coke that you drink, which is a demon, everyday Coke, it's become a demon, you know? Some things that are normal are become demonic. When you decide to give it up, and if you don't know, use Lent to give it up, you're expecting a positive result, isn't it? How can you pray? He said, which one of you would his son ask him for a fish? And he will give him a serpent for bread and give him stone. It means that we're not expecting. So why does that scripture come into? Let me round up with this. The scripture comes into because many times when we finish fasting and praying and that the enemy comes and attack, we now say, oh, but I thought I fasted and prayed. Are you expecting that you have prayed and God will give you a serpent? Are you expecting that you have prayed for bread and God will give you stone? So because all these kind of attacks has come, you are expecting, oh God, I thought I fasted and prayed. This fasted and prayed, I don't even think it works anywhere. Is that your it's because your expectation was that you will pray and God will give you a serpent. I decided I'm going to flog this topic till there will be no preacher on earth that will preach this sermon, and you won't find me inside it one way. I decided I'm sticking. You know, I said prayer a lot this year. I'm sticking with that topic. We haven't touched, this is just introduction, part one. Anyone who asks, anyone receives. Anyone who knocks, it will be open. Those doors that ask will be open. Many times when we pray, we have already mapped out how we want this thing, how we want the outcome. So God, I've prayed for my husband. So here's the outcome, God. When he comes back from work, he will just decide to cook dinner. After that, he will wash the plates. And then you've mapped it out. But when he comes back from work, he kicks off his shoes. Watches TV and says, is dinner ready yet? I'm thinking, oh, no. That's not what I was saying. And then you bring it. And for the first time in his life, in his head, in his sorry head that God is dealing with, you bring the food before. For the first time in his life. He says, oh, thank you. This is lovely. And then you still kiss your teeth. Is that not deliverance one? As he said, thank you before. But you don't know that God is working something out. But because our expectation is we are praying with a mapped out idea of how we want the outcome to come. So when God brings it another way, we feel, no, this is God. Is there anyone who will ask his father of bread and he will give him stone? Father, help us. In the name of Jesus. Let's bow our heads and pray. Whilst you pray that God help me with unbelief, is there anybody here whilst the saints are praying? You do not know Jesus, who says, ask and it shall be given unto you. I want to pray with you this afternoon. You know that you haven't asked Jesus as your Lord and Savior. I want to pray with you this afternoon. whilst the heads are bowed and the saints are praying. You want Jesus to become the Lord and Savior of your life. Jesus, who died on the cross. You didn't come to church by accident. It was because Jesus drew you. I want to pray with you. I want you to just wave your hand at me so I can identify and pray with you. It's a simple prayer. Jesus, come into my life and be the Lord and Savior of my life. If you've prayed that prayer before, you don't need to indicate. If you've not, if you know you've not been a Christian, or you're backsliding, it's a different ballgame. If you're totally backsliding from God, you no more serve God anymore, don't come to church, but today, for one reason, you came, then we want to pray with you too. Jesus. Father, I give you praise. I declare souls will be saved in this place in the name of Jesus. Next prayer point for us barren hearts. I want you to rebuke unbelief. It's unbelief that causes people to pray without expectation. Say, God, in the name of Jesus, I rebuke every unbelief. So that you know that God is King. Every unbelief that is making you think that God is not your Father. Everything that is causing you to doubt. Every double-mindedness, we rebuke in the name.